Welcome everyone to our event this evening in partnership with the Riverside Art Museum and the Cheech. My name is Katie Porter and I'm Executive Director of Inlandia Institute. And tonight we have a very special program called Celebrating Cultura. And before we get started, I would just like to say a few words. Inlandia Institute respectfully acknowledges and recognizes our responsibility to the original and current caretakers of this land, water, and air, the Kaweah, Tongva, Luiseno, and Serrano peoples, and all of their ancestors and descendants, past, present, and future. Today, the Inlandia region is home to many indigenous peoples from all over the world, and we express our gratitude to them for allowing us the opportunity to live and work in these ancestral homelands. So, and today that is especially relevant being Dia de la Raza. Here today to host our event, we have Jorge, Mr. Blue Hernandez, and I'm going to turn it over to him. Jorge is a host on Radio Aztlan who also happens to be a judge. So welcome, Jorge.
Hey, thank you so much for the invitation. When we did our last RAM program for September 16th for Gabriel Roth and Penrose Records, I threw it out there. I said, you know, we need to do something for Dia de la Raza because that day is so important. And I said, who has ideas? And right away, Francis Vasquez, who I've known since my college days at UC Riverside, sent me an email and said, I am part of this group. We would love to do a program with you. And that's kind of how the idea sprang up. Now, Dia de la Raza is very important to me and those of us who are in the Chicano movement and who have been organizers. This day has always been a day for us to bring people together collectively and talk about history and culture, whether it be by way of music with Chuy Negrete or whether it be by art installations or a variety of different things. The Chicano movement was all about trying to find a voice for ourselves. And what we've done is we appropriated this day that the entire nation celebrates as Christopher Columbus Day, the day that began the subjugation of the native peoples of this land, the day that began the obliteration of thousands and thousands of people on this continent. We've appropriated that day and we've turned it into our own day to celebrate our contributions to this state. And it's funny, now several cities and several states have now changed Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day. So we were ahead of the game 30, 40 years ago because we have been fighting for this day. And it seems that we are slowly but surely getting some of the things that we want. So that's why today is special, to find our voices. And the reason this program is important is because there are folks here who are gonna share their voices with you. So Francis, I wanna thank you for the idea. And Francis is my co-host. And so Francis, what do you wanna tell us tonight about the program this evening?
Thank you, Jorge. What I'd like to tell everyone is that in addition to today, Dia de la Raza, that we have been observing for decades as Indigenous Peoples Day, I want to do a shout out to the first peoples of this region, of the Americas, and thank you for all that we have inherited. And also, in addition to Indigenous Peoples Day today, we are doing this as part of Latino Heritage Month. And this is an opportunity for us to celebrate and honor the Latinas, Chicanas, Chicanos, people who have played and continue to play a foundational role in shaping our national culture as educators, artists, writers, healers, patriots, laborers, entertainers, entrepreneurs, political leaders. And we are very happy, Mr. Blue, that you accepted our invitation to collaborate and put on a program where we can listen to music, tell our stories, and celebrate our art culture, and that's what we're doing, celebrating culture.
You know, it's wonderful the collaboration that is taking place between Inlandia Institute, the Riverside Art Museum, and the Cheech. This is what we've always fought for, which is our ability to be able to collaborate and do programs together. So when I, you know, said we need something, the fact that Inlandia stepped forward in order to do a program just really shows that this area is really able to work together, to coalesce together, to coalition together, and it's fantastic. I'd like to introduce my good friend, Drew from the Riverside Art Museum, who is going to share some words and an update as to the Riverside Art Museum's effort to complete the Cheech for fall of 2021. Drew, are you there?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Blue. I'm Drew Obajurgi, Executive Director of the Riverside Art Museum. And on behalf of the Board of Trustees and staff, thank you so much for inviting us to co-host this event today. We are a 501c3 museum founded in 1954, and we're located on the corner of Lime and Mission Inn. We have the honor to be part of a public-private partnership with Cheech Marin and the City of Riverside to create the Cheech Marin Center for Chicano Art and Culture that's slated to open in fall 2021. This will be located in the former main library of Riverside. We are one organization. We will have two centers, one at the Julie Morgan Building on Lime and Mission Inn, and one, the Cheech, at the former main library. Our mission is to engage, inspire, and to build community by presenting thought-provoking exhibitions and providing art classes that instill a lifelong love of the arts. During COVID-19, we have turned digital and now have served students throughout the region with live stream and recorded classes. We have a variety of online exhibitions and have organized Zoom conversations with Mr. Blue, his are the most fun, about art and some of our favorite subjects like the Pachuco Ball. On November 6th, we are opening Sheila Prebright's exhibition, #1960now. Definitely opening it online, maybe in person, depending on how things go with COVID, but definitely online. Her work documents the responses to recent police shootings. Her work shows young social activists taking a stand against the same struggles their parents and grandparents endured during the era of Jim Crow. Please keep up to date with what we are doing by following the Riverside Art Museum and the Cheech on social media. Our chair of the Cheech campaign, Ophelia Valdez-Yeager, will share more about the Cheech update. But again, thank you so much for allowing the Riverside Art Museum and the Cheech to co-host.
All right, Ophelia, you're on mute. You're on mute, Ophelia.
I was trying to be so good. I'm pretty excited to share a brief update about the Cheech with everyone. Sometimes we assume that everybody knows what's happening and they don't. So thank you for the opportunity. I wanted to let you know that the renovation contract bid went out this last summer. The bids came in and we've selected a contractor. We're going to be presenting it to the City Council for approval up this fall. And we're also on schedule and working on programming such as opening exhibitions and putting together the framework for an education program that enhances community-based ethnic studies curriculum. As you may have heard, one of the key components that Cheech insisted on was education, and so we're moving forward on that. There are several surprises coming up before the opening, so I would encourage you to go to the website and stay tuned because you don't want to miss any of the things that are going on. And Jorge is always coming up with great ideas, so there are a lot of things coming up. So thank you very much, and I hope you all have a good evening, and please look for the website on the chat. Thank you.
Great ideas. That's a segue to announce two programs that are going to be coming up. October 28th, I'm going to continue my conversation with Gabriel Roth of Penrose Music. You know, we did 2 hours and 20 minutes and that wasn't enough. So the audience has asked us for part two. And then I approached Drew today about doing one November 20th on the anniversary of the Mexican Revolution and the impact that had in the United States and Chicanos living in the U.S. So we continue to do programming because that's what we do as organizers, and now we have a platform, which is the Riverside Art Museum and the Cheech, which allows us to reach an even greater audience. And even doing Zapotecnica, things like Zoom, which is something we have never done before, but we are slowly becoming experts in Zoom. So when I talked about finding Ophelia.
I'm so sorry to interrupt, but it's important that when I talked about one of the exciting things happening, and because it's coming so soon, put October 29th on your calendar. We're going to have a Zoom mini fundraiser for the Cheech, and it's going to be with Cheech and Aynar and James de la Torre. They will be the opening exhibit for the Cheech. You will have a wonderful time. So we're going to put it out on social media starting tomorrow. So put it on your calendar. You don't want to miss it. Thank you, Jorge. I'm sorry for the interruption.
Oh, no interruptions. You can interrupt me anytime you want to announce fantastic events like that. It's fantastic. I think we need to have a central calendar somewhere in order to keep track of all the wonderful events that are taking place. So when I talked about finding voices, and I talked about that's a good platform for this, music was also a way that gente found their voice. And I did a program on Saturday where we did a variety of different types of music. But as I sat back and listened to all of them, music really is the creation when two cultures collide. I remember when I took Carlos Cortez for Chicano history, my first year of college, he talked about thesis, antithesis, and synthesis, and how that creates something. Well, that was too academic for me. I just like to say when worlds collide, beautiful things happen. So all of you listen to mariachi music. Well, that was the influence of European and the French. Some of you listen to polkas, shotis, and redobos. That's the influence of the Germans. That's the influence of the Polish. In Texas, the accordion gave way to the Hammond organ, and you saw groups like Rocky Gill and the Bishops, Shorty and the Corvettes, Sonny and the Sunliners, Little Joe and the Latineers, and that whole style of music. In the 40s, blues and swings mixed together with Pachuca Calo and came up with Pachuco boogie music. And the Cuban protest music, the Honduran protest music, the Nicaraguan protest music met the Chicano movement. And then you had groups like Los Alacranes Mojados, Los Peludos, Chuy Negrete, and that kind of stuff. And then the soul music hit the airwaves and Chicanos were listening to that type of music. So you got, you know, again, Little Joe and the Latineers, you got Sonny Osuna and the Sunliners, and then you had Joe Bethon, and then you had the Midnighters, and you had the Blendells, and you had the Jaguars, and you had the Solace Brothers. So music is also a voice. So tonight, while we're, after we listen to some of these folks, I'm going to try to play a different style of music as it relates to each break. So mariachi, Tex-Mex, soldies, Chicano movement, that kind of stuff. Just kind of give you a little bit. I can do 2 hours on music, but I don't have 2 hours. So Francis, let me turn it over to you. Francis will be our main host for that, and I'll just be the interlude guy playing some music. So Francis.
Thank you, Jorge. I just love when you talk about music because the passion exudes. Tonight, in addition to the música that Jorge is going to play with us, we have readings and we have pláticas. So next up is Liz Gonzalez. She's author of Dancing in the Santa Ana Winds, and she grew up in the IE. Liz. Unmute.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to read two poems. You're not like a real Mexican. You're like us, declared my Dolly Parton Puffy Doo coworker as I stepped into her office to get some desk supplies. She smiled, bright as the fluorescent lights, as though she had given me a compliment. Another reminder, I was an affirmative action hire and the first and only brown office employee. I stood beside her, looked her in the eye, and said, Oh, yeah? How's that? I thought she'd say I didn't have an accent or some other rotten slight I'd smelled before. Her pale cheeks blossomed like a prize pink rose filled with pride as she told me her story. My dad was a dentist, and Wednesday was low income day. The farm workers used to come in throngs of families, you know, dirty, probably have bugs, too dumb to learn English, immigrants. I was always afraid they'd steal something or rape me. Those men really go for blondes. They don't have any over there. My tongue thickened and numbed, concerned about my job. If I whipped out sharp comebacks, I stayed silent and considered how to respond. I wanted to tell her that my immigrant father's mother had blue eyes and real blonde hair without a bleached frost job, that my father's family worked in the fields and orchards near her father's office, and her childhood meals probably included the fruits of their labor. And that if she'd step outside her white lines, she might find true love with a Mexican, someone who'd appreciate her lonjas, so she could stop starving for men who never called again. I did manage to fake a smile and find some words that wouldn't get me in trouble. My father's family could have been your father's patient. And here I am today, working beside you. Both our fathers would be proud. This next one is from my book, Dancing in the Santa Ana Winds. Confession of a Pseudo Chicana. Forgive me, Our Lady Virgin of Guadalupe, for I have offended you. It has been 8 months since I lit a votive or ate a bowl of menudo. These are my sins. I refused to taste hot chili until I was 18. Mama raised us on hamburger helper and macaroni and cheese. She never even made a pot of beans. I learned how to make tortillas from Mrs. McDougal in Home Ec. Mama still uses the recipe. In high school, I bonged with Allman Brother lookalikes and rocked out to Lynyrd Skynyrd more than I suavecitoed to Malo and El Chicano. After dancing at 49 Mexican weddings, I still don't know what the lyrics to Sabor a Mi mean. I can't even speak fluent Spanglish. My biggest sin of all? I ate grapes during the boycott, but Mama made me. Forgive me, Madre Maria. I was brought up by a mama who thought Chicano was a dirty word and a grandma who claims she's Italian. Keep me from turning into a vendida with blue contacts and help me to be more Chicana than coconut. No matter how pochified I've become, I will never forget that great grandpa sweat glistens on the metal of Santa Fe Railroad tracks. Good old boys brand and corral cousins like cattle they own and slaughter. Ninas stitch arthritis into their fingers inside maquiladoras. Tio's skin, eyes, lung, get fumigated with pesticide every day. Madre Maria, instead of kindling candles with your image to look cool, I'll light the wicks in remembrance of them. Thank you.
De la guitarra mía, al despertar la mañana, quiere cantar su alegría a mi tierra. regione canto a tus volcanes, a tus praderas y flores, que son como talismanes del amor de mis amores. México lindo y querido, si vuelves de mí, que digan que estoy dormido y que me traigan a ti. Que digan que estoy dormido y que me traigan a ti. México lindo y querido, si muero de lejos de ti. Me entierren en la sierra, al pie de los magueyales, y que me cubra esta tierra, que es cuna de hombres cabales, desde la guitarra mía, al despertar la mañana. Quiere cantar su alegría a mi tierra.
Francis?
Excellent. Excellent. Ahua. Next up, we have Reflections on Riverside's Chicano Community by Dr. Carlos E. Cortez. He is UCR Professor Emeritus of History and co-director of its Medical School's Health Equity Initiative. Thank you, Dr. Cortez.
Thank you, Francis. Last week, I gave a talk for Hispanic Heritage Month for the Riverside Unified School District. Tonight, I'm going to read you that talk. So if you're in the mood, put yourself in the role of a school board member listening to this talk. Thank you for the opportunity of speaking for Hispanic Heritage Month. I thought long and hard about what I should say. Latino population growth, well, you know the story. Hispanic culture, you've heard that dozens of times. I don't want to make this Groundhog Day. So instead, I decided to tell you some stories. Stories about the local Latino community. Stories from the perspective of an outsider. You see, I'm not from Riverside. I arrived here in December 1967 to become a UCR history professor. I've stayed nearly 53 years. My wife and I love it here. As an outsider, when I think of the local Latino community, a few words pop into my head. Historical, after all, Enizaros in New Mexico settled here in the early 1840s, while this was still a part of Mexico, nearly 30 years before John W. North arrived. Proud, contributing, but especially embracing of outsiders. I'd only been here a few weeks when I got involved in a voter registration drive led by two local Chicanas, Dee Garcia and Jenny Gracia. They made me feel at home. A Kansas City güero with a Missouri twang. I was the second Chicano professor in UCR history. At that time, the campus had only about 100 Chicano students. Shortly after I arrived, they formed the United Mexican American Students, which became today's MECHA. As chair of UCR Chicano Studies program for 7.5 years, I worked closely with MECHA. Then along came another outsider, Woodrow Diaz, a Puerto Rican. This was long before people talked about Latinos and Hispanics. Ethnically alone on campus, Woody asked if he could join MECHA. In embracing Riverside style, the students declared him an honorary Chicano. In 1979 came another outsider, a Texas Chicano named Tomas Rivera. He had just been named UCR chancellor, the first minority chancellor in UC history. The local Chicano community welcomed him with an enormous reception at the Riverside Convention Center. Many people at UCR welcomed him too, especially students and staff who loved this gracious, open, truly authentic man. But not all of the faculty embraced him. Shortly after Tomas' first meeting with the UCR Academic Senate, one faculty member came to his office and shared what the professor referred to as a really funny story. While chuckling, the professor quoted another faculty member as saying, "You know, I can understand why Governor Brown put a Chicano in as chancellor at Riverside for political reasons. Did he have to look so much like a Chicano?" That story burrowed into Tomas' psyche. He repeated it in public lectures. Even as chancellor, he knew that he was on ethnic probation. 5 years later, in 1984, Tomas died of a heart attack. We'll never know how much the pain of ethnic probation contributed to his death. 8 years later, in 1992, another Texas Chicano, Robert Nava, a Riverside Unified School District board member, proposed naming a new school after Tomas. What could be better? A tribute to an educational pioneer who had brought national visibility to Riverside? A success symbol to inspire Latino youth? Someone in whom all of Riverside could take pride. It should have been a slam dunk, except it wasn't. Opposition arose. Opposition from some UCR faculty, opposition from some school board members. Surprised by this opposition, board member-elect Ophelia Valdez-Yeager asked me to speak in support of Tomas at the December 1st, 1992 meeting where the final vote was to be taken. I spoke, and Tomas won. But it was a bittersweet victory. What should have been a universal celebration of inclusion had become a traumatic probationary moment for the local Latino community. My friend Ellis Coase, a brilliant African-American public intellectual, wrote what I consider to be the very best book on race. It's called The Rage of a Privileged Class. In it, Ellis focuses on the experience of educated, high-achieving, upper-middle-class African-Americans. What Ellis found is that despite their achievements, these African-American success stories still encountered situations, surprising situations, shocking situations, where the color of their skin abruptly marginalized them. Despite their accomplishments and contributions, they were still on probation. About a year ago, Ellis asked me if the same thing was happening among Latinos. I said, I didn't think so. I had seen Latinos angry. I had neither witnessed nor felt the kind of deep rage that Ellis wrote about. But I'd come close that 1992 night at the school board meeting. But what I have sensed in the Latino community is weariness, a sense of disbelief, of regularly being overlooked despite rapidly growing numbers, of being taken for granted, a sense of impatience. When will enough be enough? Then along came Los Angeles comedian actor Cheech Marin. A few years ago, he spoke at the opening of his Chicano art exhibit in Riverside. The local Latino community lined up for hours to embrace him. Completely overwhelmed, Cheech decided that Riverside would be the perfect place to permanently house his private art Chicano art collection, the nation's finest. It will be housed in the old downtown library. The entire community can take pride in it. Will help make Riverside a true destination. And yet, in the November 2018 election, one candidate made opposition to the Cheech part of his campaign. Candidate lost. The final outsider, a Panamanian American embraced by the local Latino community, is State Assemblyman Jose Medina, my former UCR student. A few years ago, Jose launched a long shot effort to make ethnic studies a California high school graduation requirement. With grit and determination, Jose nearly beat the odds. The legislature passed the requirement this past August, but it was vetoed last week by Governor Gavin Newsom. But Jose will be back like the Terminator. I was deeply involved. Last fall, the chair of the California State Board of Education asked me if I would compose a set of ethnic studies principles to help the state deal with the enormous controversy over the original model ethnic studies curriculum report. The state liked my document well enough that it included my principles nearly verbatim in chapter one of the revised model curriculum. In developing those principles, I circulated drafts among dozens of people and met with numerous community groups. At those meetings, I cautioned people that the passage of Jose's bill and the model curriculum would be only the first stage. The real action lay with how school districts implemented it. At last month's board meeting, you approved the new district ethnic studies graduation requirement. I'm delighted. Now, I hope you'll make certain that Latinos finally get their due in the curriculum. I hope all of you accept that responsibility individually, not just collectively. I recognize that you represent the entire community, as it should be, but Riverside is not just a collection of random individuals. It is also a collection of communities. So as I conclude, I appeal to each of you, not only to be representatives of the district, but also to be strong advocates for those who for far too long have often felt on probation. Thank you.
That was wonderful. Thank you very much, Jorge. Dr. Cortez, thank you for that very relevant discussion on the reflections of Riverside's Chicano community. Next up, we have another very relevant discussion that's going to be led by Minerva Canto. She's a journalist who writes short fiction and is working on a memoir. And she is going to talk about cultural identity. And several of us are going to chime in during her discussion. And it will be followed by a reading from one of Minerva's creative writing. Take it away, Minerva.
Thank you, Francis. I'm so honored and happy to be here at this event, sponsored by three fantastic cultural institutions. Cultural identity is a complex topic for us in the Latino community. We could probably spend hours talking and perhaps even arguing about it. Latino, Latina, Latinx, Hispanic, Afro-Latino, Chicano, Chicana, Chicanx. So many terms, and there's even more than that. Which one best describes us as a community? I once went to a meeting where people discussing this topic became so heated they began throwing chairs. Why is this something that inspires such passion? Perhaps it's because the ability to self-identify is something many of us don't take for granted. We know how important it is. How we identify is directly related to our own distinct experiences and that of our ancestors. Acknowledgement, acceptance, and celebration of our cultural identity is sometimes a long journey. That was certainly the case for me in claiming my identity as American or estadounidense. I was born in Mexico City and have lived in the United States since I was 6 years old. But I didn't feel justified in calling myself an American until I became a naturalized citizen and began voting. I also consider myself Mexican, Mexican-American, Latina, and I do think of myself as Chicana at heart because of my many years of working to advance the ideals of the California Chicano News Media Association. And I also identify as Latinx. Though I know it's not a term everyone likes, I embrace it because it's inclusive of communities that haven't always felt accepted or welcome. Perhaps one day we'll come up with a better term that is all inclusive and respectful of our histories. Language is always evolving and fluid. As a reporter, I often ask people how they identify. The responses are varied, and I find it fascinating to learn even more just how diverse our cultura really is. Among our presenters tonight, we found a good mix as well. For example, Juanita, could you tell us about your cultural identity and how you self-identify?
Hi, thank you, Minerva. I identify as Mexican, Mexican-American, Latina, Latinx. My mom is Mexican, my dad is Yugoslavian German, but I've always claimed that Mexican side of me, I think because I'm brown. And I was always drawn to that culture. My dad was an orphan, so I didn't really interact with his family at all. And even though I'm a pocha, I still claim to be Latina. So.
And Liz?
Hi. Yes, I am Chicana, Mexican, Mexican-American. That's how I self-identify, and I don't mind Latinx, Chicanx. I like to be inclusive, so I accept those terms.
Mr. Blue?
I come from a long line of gente who are from Arizona, and that term Chicano has been used by my grandparents, my mother, and myself. So for me, there was never any other word but Chicano. La plebe, la raza, la chicanada. So growing up, that has always been my term. Even as a judge, that is my term. I never refer to myself as anything else because I am not anything else. Yo soy Chicano, tengo valor. Americano, pero con honor.
I love that. How about you, Francis?
I have identified as Chicana since I was 12 years old. I am Mexicana. I am Mexican-American, Latina, but I still consider myself Chicana. When I write something about the community, I will discuss Mexican-American community, Latina, Latino community, but in terms of my self-identity, it will always be Chicana.
That's great. How about you, Carlos?
Well, my father is from Guadalajara, an immigrant, and I grew up thinking of myself as Mexicano, but once I got out to the West Coast, Chicano took over and it's never left me. Chicano, Although it doesn't bother me if others use Hispanic or Latinx, a term which I don't like and which I find to be not inclusive at all, but to be exclusive, with 97% of the latest surveys saying that they don't use the term Latinx. So I avoid it. But if people individually want to identify, that's fine. And if the majority of Latinos take Latinx, I'll go along with it. I just don't think it'll happen.
Thank you, everyone. I really appreciated hearing from everybody, and I hope some of you did too. For my reading tonight, I'll be taking you back to the beginning of my cultural journey. A short guide to finding your first home in the United States. First, remember what life was like when you and your family lived in a two-car garage. Santa Ana was a small city, and you wondered why there were hardly any people walking on the streets. Few of them looked like you, even less spoke Spanish. It was 1977. You were 7 years old, newly arrived from Mexico City. One afternoon, you were sitting on the curb with a book in hand, waiting for your friend, and your sister came running over. Come play with us. She and a group of friends needed one more player for a kickball team. Please. You reluctantly agreed and followed her to the neighbor's front yard, a sprawling expanse of green. That day, the lawn was surrounded by low-lying white twine held up by wooden stakes to protect new sod. Outfield players took their assigned spots, everybody's sneakers casting deep dents in the soft green carpet. You were up first. You waited for the ball, kicked it, and ran fast toward first base. Suddenly, you tripped on the twine and your forehead hit the faded red cement step leading to the front door. You heard screaming, then your sister's voice as she gently turned you over. More screaming. So much blood! No one ran to get your parents. Instead, your sister put one hand under your neck and another under your head as Maria, her best friend, put her arms under your legs. They were 10 years old, their bodies not much bigger than yours, but they felt the weight of responsibility more than the weight of your body. Perdóname, perdóname, your sister said, apologizing over and over through her tears. Together, they lifted you up from the ground and carried you next door where you lived. Papa administered first aid, and you made your first trip to the hospital. It took 11 stitches to close the gash that exposed a small part of your skull. As the days passed, you became aware your life wasn't the norm. It's not just that you lived in a garage. You'd managed to advance past English as a second language classes after just 1 year in the United States, thanks to spending hours in the library and at home reading books. Being in a mainstream classroom, you saw how different your life as a newly arrived immigrant was from kids who were born in the United States. The easy way they spoke English, so self-confident they weren't mispronouncing any words. The division between those who spoke English fluently and those who didn't was clear. Those who didn't were teased and called WABs, short for wetbacks. It was an ugly term for people who came to the United States by swimming across the Rio Grande. You became determined to fit in, to become like everyone else. After your accident playing kickball, you became obsessed with the way your face looked. The bandages on your forehead set you apart from everyone else, even other immigrant kids. You didn't like it when other kids stared at you. One blustery February day, the bandages and stitches were finally scheduled to come off. Light raindrops washed the streets clean as you and Mama took the bus to the hospital. Mama had taken a rare morning off from work. Everything seemed to look brighter after the rain, making you giddy with anticipation. You almost didn't mind as the doctor tugged on your forehead as he removed each stitch, one by one. You tried not to squirm, anticipating the joy of having once more a face no one noticed. Finally, all the stitches were off. Please, I want to see, you told Mama. She didn't want to show you, but you insisted. With small mirror finally in hand, you were horrified to discover that tiny black train tracks ran along part of your forehead. The bruising hadn't completely healed. Tiny bits of dried blood remained where the surgical string had been. There was no way around it. Your face looked monstrous. No, that wasn't too harsh a word for what your forehead looked like at that moment. Even Frankenstein had stitches running down his forehead. Who could say the image in the mirror wouldn't always look like that? Mama told you further healing would take place in the coming days. Sure, the doctor said the same thing, but you were an immigrant kid. You'd known your share of disappointments and had no reason to believe you'd seen the last of them. You cried and begged to go home for the rest of the day. Mama, I can't go to school looking like this. She needed to take you to school right away so she could work the rest of her shift at the sewing factory. But Mama did agree you could wear your knit hat all day so your forehead could stay covered. You were learning, little by little, what parts of yourself were safe to reveal. Thank you. That was an excerpt from an essay in an immigrant anthology soon to be published by Inlandia.
Yo sé que al verme me muestras disgusto. Te produce enfado. Y te hace daño que a buscar te venga. Siempre de mi lado, ojos que lloran sin saber de mí, y van llorando por el mundo entero. Pero tú en cambio me muestras decenas. Y así me pagas lo que yo te quiero.
Excellent. Great choice of music, Jorge. Minerva, that was such a powerful, powerful story. Can't wait to read it in the anthology. Next up, we have a very stimulating conversation coming on, and we are going to talk about, well, we're going to have Liz back, Liz Gonzalez, author of Dancing in the Santa Ana Winds, who grew up in the IE, and we're going to have Juanita E. Mance Jam as an Inland Empire writer, performer, podcaster, and a deputy public defender. They're going to lead a discussion on Chicanx, Latinx literature by Macondistas. Take it away, Liz and Jam.
Hi. Did you want to say hi, Jam? Can you
hi,
hear me?
Everyone.
Hi, everyone. So I'm going to, Jem and I are going to trade off. I'm going to first tell you a little bit about Macondo Writers Workshop. Since 2006, I've been a proud Macondista, which is how Macondo members are referred to. The Macondo Writers Workshop is an inclusive association of socially engaged master's level writers working to advance creativity, foster generosity, and serve community. And Macondo is similar to a conference in that we meet once a year, and not everybody returns every year, but we meet once a year, usually in July, for 4 days to a week in San Antonio, Texas. The program includes daily creative writing workshops facilitated by poets and writers of note, pláticas, presentations often conducted by Macondistas on a variety of topics such as writing children's books, publishing, and current issues, readings by faculty members and current and past Macondistas, and lots of socializing and solidarity. Mocondo was founded in 1995 by renowned author Sandra Cisneros at her former home in San Antonio, Texas. She gathered a group of writers, artists, scholars, and activists around her kitchen table to meet informally for rigorous writing workshops, and it grew into an annual event from there. Cisneros named it Mocondo after the town in Gabriel Garcia Marquez's novel, 100 Years of Solitude. One of the things I love about Mocondo is a compassionate code of conduct, a document drafted by a group of past Macondistas outlining the principles and ethics that govern Mocondo. Everyone has to sign and submit a copy before participating in the annual event. Among other things, we are encouraged to create a kind, generous, respectful, creative, and passionate community, and to be our most generous selves during our week at Mocondo. I mean, how beautiful is that? Sandra has not been running the Mocondo workshop for over 6 years, but she continues to support it in many ways. Since 2018, Mocondo's been run by a rotating board made up of Macondistas and meets at the Texas A&M University in San Antonio. Jim?
Sure. Thank you, Liz. Great history on that. I was admitted into Mocondo in 2017 at the urging of Liz Gonzalez, who encouraged me to apply. When I was admitted, I couldn't believe it. I thought, oh my gosh, I'm going to this magical place. And it really is a magical experience. That first year I took a class with Stephanie Elizondo Gris, who wrote All the Agents and Saints, Dispatches from the U.S. Borderlands. Which was released about 2 years ago. And she also wrote a memoir called Around the Block about a Latina living in Moscow. I went again in 2018 and studied under Joy Castro. And the thing about Mocondo is it's that community. It's inclusive, it's intersectional, but they both of my teachers there really encouraged me to find my voice both as a memoirist, but also as a lawyer. And I think once I started merging those two worlds and they collided, as Jorge would say, magic happened. And I realized that my voice and stories had the power to change systemic systems. And something moved in the universe for me. Mocondo really made me believe my voice mattered. And because of that, I decided to get my MFA while remaining a public defender part-time. It is the community that is the magic of Mocondo. Lorraine Lopez, poet Richard Blanco, Norma Cantu, and of course, my shiro, Sandra Cisneros, who when I met her, I couldn't even say a word. I was overwhelmed. I'd loved her since I was a little junior high student reading her book. And the best thing about Mocondo is once you are a Macondista, you are one for life. And that's how I feel. I'm in it for life. I feel blessed to be part of this group of writers, somewhat unworthy at times, but very grateful that I'm allowed into that tribe.
So I was fortunate to participate in Sandra Cisneros' workshop twice. The first time I went and the most recent time I went. Some other well-known faculty that have facilitated workshops at Mocondo are Julia Alvarez, fiction writer and poet, Ruth Behar, fiction and creative nonfiction writer and amazing scholar, Tim Z. Hernandez, creative nonfiction writer and poet, Carla Trujillo, novelist and essayist, Luis Rodriguez, poet and fiction and creative nonfiction writer and former LA Poet Laureate, Joy Harjo, who is indigenous, she's not Chicanx or Latinx, but she's poet and memoirist, and she's the current U.S. Poet Laureate, and another indigenous writer, Allison Adele Hedge Koch, poet and memoirist, distinguished professor of creative writing at UC Riverside. some Latinx Macondistas from the IE or are or were active in the IE, in addition to Gemini, are Alex Espinosa, novelist and creative nonfiction writer, who's the current Tomas Rivera Endowed Chair of Creative Writing at UC Riverside, Cassandra Lopez, poet and fiction writer, John Olivares Espinosa, poet, and Tisha Marie Reichle Aguilera, fiction writer. I have some of the books and some of Inlandia's anthologies here beside me, keeping me calm as I go do this presentation. Take it away, Jim.
And I also wanted to highlight some Inland Empire Latino and Latina and Latinx writers. Isabel Quintero, who's from Corona, who wrote one of my favorite books, if you haven't read it, Gabby, A Girl in Pieces. It was published by a Texas press, Cinco Punto. It's just a marvel. The voice she writes in this YA, overweight Latinx girl that loves to eat Cheetos. And then there's Irene Sanchez, who's from Riverside, Adam Daniel Martinez, who is from San Bernardino, Alex Avila, who's from New York, but he's a professor at Cal State San Bernardino, and a lot of his work takes place in the IE, and Natalie Hurt, who got her MFA at UC Riverside, who I know, and all of her stories, especially the memoir pieces, they illustrate Riverside so well. And I came to the Inland Empire when I was 3. Most of my memoir is based in Ontario, California. And I really love writers like Liz and Natalie and others that are immersed in place culturally. I think it says everything about who you are when you write about your hometown.
So a few more writers of note from the Inland Empire or who were or are active in the IE that I wanted to mention. Juan Delgado, he's a poet and professor at Cal State USB. Kathleen Alcala, she's a novelist and creative nonfiction writer. Juan Felipe Herrera, California and U.S. Poet Laureate and former Tomas Rivera Endowed Chair of Creative Writing. Manuel Delgado, a Chicano activist and memoirist, and he wrote the book Last Chicano, and there are so many more that we don't have the time to include. Thank you so much.
Chicanos do it all, man.
Woman, take care of your man. Give him love and strength. For he will stay. And he don't take no breaks. He wants to provide for his family, so one day his children will be free. And don't worry, don't shed no tears. Only the strong shall survive in these jungle streets. You must stand strong like a lion. Aztec Empire, keep rising. We'll be forever La Raza. We'll be forever La Raza. On and on and on. We'll be forever La Raza. Together forever. We'll be forever La Raza. Don't let them fool ya.
Don't let them teach you wrong. With Eurocentric lies, this is the land of our people. Nobody here is illegal. Don't let them change ya. Be down for who you are. Stand tall with pride and represent your culture. Pa'lante, hermano, hermana. Pa'lante, chicano, chicana. Together we'll be forever la raza.
Jorge, that was awesome. Love your music. Hopefully we can have a playlist sometime soon. Well, guess what, folks? It's my turn. And again, I'm Frances Vasquez, and I'm with the Inlandia Institute, Director Emerita. And I'm a local woman. And I'm going to read a story that I wrote called Pilgrimage to Sonora. And it's going to be in Inlandia's upcoming Immigrant Experience Anthology. I'm going to give you background. One day I received a phone call no one wishes for. The urgent message to go quickly to Mexico. Our mother was dying. In Mexico, death waits for no one. They bury their dead the very next day. So I rushed to Mexico, Ciudad Obregón, Sonora, and I went to the hospital as soon as I arrived. And my mother was intubated on life support. The doctors had advised the family that she was going to die any moment now, for us to prepare her burial. Well, guess what? Mama started to recover. So I'm gonna read from when she started to recover. One day, when we were alone, Mama shared with me that she had felt some excruciating pain, that she wanted to die, and begged God to take her. After praying to San Charbel, she felt a hand press firmly on her forehead, and then the pain diminished. Fue un milagro. It was a miracle, we concluded. And then another day, she's still in the hospital, Mama stated that she had noticed that I wore black clothes a lot. Amused and with a straight face, I replied diplomatically, "Sí, Mama, yes, I like to wear black. It's such a classic color that goes well with everything." I didn't want to reveal the truth that I had brought mostly dark clothes for me to wear to her intended wake and funeral. I knew then that Mama would recuperate. Her keen observation skills were intact. 2 weeks after Mama's critical hospitalization, doctors declared her well enough to go home. The hand of God prevailed through spiritual intervention, prayers of the faithful. A skilled medical team, diligent family support, music, and Mama's indomitable Yaqui warrior spirit all played vital roles in her remarkable recovery from the brink of death. I'm going to fast forward to a fiesta. The 10-member Mariachi Los Halcones strolled into Mama's home performing her favorite happy tune, El Mariachi Loco, the crazy mariachi. The mariachi serenaded Rosalía on the festive occasion of her recovery and homecoming. It was joyful. My warrior mother returned to her humble home after a terrifying experience. Mama sat stoically in a wheelchair listening to the mariachi music. Sentimental, Mama wiped tears of joy with the soft beige rebozo I had brought her from Beijing. The lively music made her happy. Her spirits rejoiced to be home again, surrounded by adoring children, grandchildren, her loved ones. Mama was given a second chance at life. And in the Judeo-Christian tradition, dancing is considered double prayer. After having recited countless rosaries, novenas, and heartfelt oraciones for Mama's healing, we jump for joy, knowing our prayers were heard. We celebrated Rosalía. Outside, on the hard-packed earthen patio, the mariachi performed a medley of cumbias, a fast-paced genre of Latino music that's very tropical in nature. La Loba, Las Hijas de Don Simón. Rosalía's faithful kin danced with relief to the spirited cumbia rhythms. The dancing and singing released the pent-up stress, fear, and anxiety that we had all been plagued with. A spontaneous circle of dancing daughters formed during Juana la Cubana. With appropriate abandon, we shook our full womanly hips to the circular dance of joy. We shimmied our strong feminine shoulders to the rhythms. La Prenda, La Rosa, La Denise, and others. We all danced with clapping, swinging hands. Flashing toothy smiles, we cumbia to the vibrant lyrics. Bailame suavecita, sabrosita. With smooth hip gyrations and amplified shouts of glee, we paid tribute to Nuestra Madre. We honored Mama with dances and songs of praise and gratitude. I felt so much gratefulness for the reunions that emerged during our Sonoran family. My half-brother Saul had been estranged from Mama for several years, even though he lived nearby in Providencia. The trauma of Mama's near death stirred him to visit her at the hospital and beg forgiveness. Graciously, my cousins Panchi and Lupe went to visit Mama for the first time in several years. Amazingly, my 105-year-old beloved Tia Cuquita went into her sister-in-law's house for the first time in decades. We were overjoyed. Tia and my mother, Tia Cuquita, made the trek to bid me farewell just an hour before I left Obregón. Indeed, Mama's motherland, my second home, my sacred place, evokes familial bliss whenever I return. Thank you very much for listening.
Los calcos en charol para el árbol. Chicano. Chuco Chicano.
You know, I want to introduce Juanita from the Public Defender's Office. Now, I have heard her name many, many, many times, but she has never graced my presence and being in my courtroom. I guess, you know, she was banned to banning once, but never came back again. So, Juanita, if you could share with us your reading tonight.
Thank you so much. I'm gonna go out to Banning just to make an appearance in front of you. So I'm going to read two very short excerpts from my memoir. The first one is called My Tia Tilly. Tia Tilly has a laugh like a wild horse and a dying hyena. Right now, I can tell by the way Tilly is laughing that she and Mom are reliving their days growing up together. Tilly's and Mom's conversations go back and forth from Spanish to English. When they speak Spanish, they think we don't understand, but we can usually figure it out through what my teacher calls context. Mom and Tilly used to live down the street from each other in Buena Park from Knott's Berry Farm when it was still a farm. My mom's dad used to own a lot of land in Buena Park and he sold it off for nothing. Tilly met my mom at a bus stop and they became best of friends. Tilly ended up marrying Mom's brother, Pancho. He is the third oldest of my mom's many brothers. Right now, my mom is hunching over the dining table, stirring her coffee, alternating sips with laughter. Tilly, remember when you used to sneak into Pancho's room all baracho? Mom's laughing so hard that I can see the back of her throat. She never laughs like this at home. Mom doesn't have a lot to laugh about, what with chasing dad down at bars, waiting tables at Yangzi's Chinese restaurant, and working the graveyard shift at Circle K. You see, Mom is a different person at Tilly's house. Calmer, she seems younger. She talks to Tilly about how they had dirt floors and all the rock and roll concerts they would go to in Orange County. They also talk about how Mom was the only brown girl in her class. The best part of our visit is when they pull out the photo album. My sisters and I lean over the table, taking pictures off the sticky backing. In Mom's sixth grade photo, she has a sharp overbite and her dark skin stands out against the whiteness of her classmates in the black and white photo. Mom won't talk much about that time, but she'll admit it wasn't easy being Mexican back then. It was hard, she will say with a sad look. I didn't know English well. It was hard. The second story is called Stay Gold. It's just an excerpt. Johnny Cash's voice wafts through the air. I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. Mom's at work, so Dad's downstairs in the condo we live in, listening to country music and drinking all the beer he wants. He's been drinking even more Budweiser since he lost the house and his bar. Mom says he's happy as a pig in shit when he drinks. Dad's only income is from his disability payments, so Mom's working two jobs to pay the bills. She works the night shift at Yangzi's and a couple graveyard shifts as a cashier at Circle K. Before mom left for work, they got into another fight. Their same fight is on repeat, like my favorite Smiths album. Mom screamed at him, "John, my brothers always told me that my baracho gringo husband would put me in the poorhouse one day. They were right." Dad had muttered his usual response from his lazy boy. "Judy, you know you let me buy that bar." You see, Dad opened a country bar in Ontario, California, and it folded after a few years. Mom and Dad love country music. They met at a honky-tonk in Portland. Mom said she always had a thing for white man cowboys. Even though Mom is Mexican, she loves country. Her favorite singer is Freddie Fender. And when she puts on her Western jean fringe suit, she looks like a Mexican version of Loretta Lynn. You see, we saw Loretta Lynn at the Pomona Fair when we were six. I hear the door slam and think, Dad's going to a bar. It's so quiet, I am all alone in the house. My sisters are out. I change the station from Dad's hillbilly one to K-Rock. Tapping my feet, I hum along to the song White Girl by my favorite punk band, X. People call me white girl all the time because my dad's white. But I always say to them, I am not a white girl. I am brown and Mexican like my mom. But then I think to myself, maybe I don't fit in anywhere. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Es la banda rebelde, es la banda rebelde que cantaré porque somos chicanos, porque somos chicanos de East LA, allá arriba y arriba. Allá arriba y arriba y arriba iré, yo no creo en fronteras. Yo no creo en fronteras, yo cruzaré, yo cruzaré, yo cruzaré.
It's beautiful how you take an old song like La Bamba and you interject politics in it, you know, identity, Chicano. I'm not illegal. I'm not undocumented. We're fighting leyes racistas. So music in an old format can be recycled to a new format in order to give a new message. And the beauty of Chicano music is that you're always looking backwards and kind of reinventing it, trying to take some of it and doing something new with it, you know? And that's what we do with our poetry. That's what we do with our art, because most of the pieces have reached back into history to talk about those memories that had a great impact on you, whether it be trying to fit in and not be a pocha, or being a redneck country girl from Ontario, or being disfigured, it matters not. Those memories leave such a profound impression on all of us. I believe they make up who we are. And sometimes it leaks out in poetry, and sometimes it leaks out in a short story, and sometimes in music. So Katie sent me a private message. She says that we have potentially some questions. So if anybody wants to, either in the chat portion or in the question portion, if you want to, if you have any questions, now is the time. Francis?
Yes, I just want to at this time, thank you very much, Jorge, for the music that you have played. I also want to thank the writers and the speakers, Minerva Canto, Dr. Carlos E. Cortez, Liz Gonzalez, and Juanita E. Metz. I want to thank the Inlandia Institute, the Riverside Art Museum, and the Cheech for this wonderful collaboration. Jorge, you've been a phenomenal host, and I just want to tell the audience that who may not know too much about the Inlandia Institute, we are a literary and publishing center based in Riverside, serving the entire inland area. We have a satellite office in San Bernardino, and the motto for Inlandia is celebrating the region in word, image, and sound. We are a nonprofit organization sustained by donations. And everyone here is welcome to join and contact Katie regarding membership. We appreciate all you do. Inlandia puts on creative writing workshops, author events, all by Zoom nowadays. However, we still do our work. And I want to invite you to some upcoming events. November 5th is the launch of the 2019 Writings from Inlandia. That's on first Thursday. And then December the 3rd is the launch of the Immigrant Experience Anthology, again, first Thursday. And you can read Minerva Canto's beautiful story, and you can read mine if you'd like to. In terms of my portion here, before we say adios, I want to share with you one of my very favorite dichos or a saying. Las palabras vuelan, los escritos quedan, which means words fly, writings endure. And so let's write a rich oral tradition that we have, our oral histories, and pass it on to our families, an enduring family legacy for our children, our grandchildren. So when we're gone, our memories will still endure. Thank you so much for joining us on this Día de la Raza.
Ike. I am so proud to be part of this group of wonderful women. You noticed all women except for Carlos and I, but Drew, Ophelia, Liz, Juanita, Minerva, Francis, Katie, women rock, they rule the world, right? And I'm glad that you allowed me to be part of your mundo, right? So I didn't see any questions posted on chat at all. There was some questions regarding the music. The last song I played was La Bamba Rebelde, La Cafeteras. The song before that was Raza by Maíz and the B-side Players. Prior to that, I played Los Relámpagos. And then prior to that, I played Peanuts, La Cacahuata by Sunny and the Sunglows. Mexico Lindo by Vicente. And I started the program Soy del Pueblo by Flor del Pueblo, and also Hijos del Sol by Conjunto Aslan out of San Antonio, Texas. We don't believe in Chicano time, so we don't start late, and we don't end late. So it's 8:26. We're to end at 8:30. So I'm going to play my favorite Midnighters tune to kind of end out tonight's program. Muchas gracias. Fue un placer.
has got to stop. But every time I give a girl all the love that I have got, she breaks my heart and then leaves me in tears. It's such a shame, but it's been going on for years. Why won't they admit and just give in a little? You can't make ends meet by leaving love out the middle. I'm the type of guy that hates to see a lovely face crying. But what can you do when you find out that that face you've been a loving ain't been doing nothing but a lying? Well, it makes no difference what she says or what she does or what it was. I know I'm through. Time and by autumn your face will be full of tears. Cause the woman that you love, she puts you down. She says she don't want you hanging around no more. Believe me, I'm hurt. But I don't wanna be the one to say that this has got to stop. But every time I give a girl all the love that I have got, she breaks my heart in two, leaves me looking like a fool. There just ain't nothing I can do. But it's time that we all admit and just give in a little. You can't make ends meet by leaving love out the middle.
Man, there's no better way to end this program. Buenas noches a todos. Buenas noches.
Buenas noches y adiós.
Que Dios le Dios le cuide porque yo cobro.
Buenas noches.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night, everybody. Thank you for coming. Thank you, panelists. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jorge. Night. Thank you, Francis. Thank you, Liz and Minerva and Carlos and Juanita. This was wonderful.
Yes, fantastic.
Everybody, have a good night.
Epic. Good night.